Is it nothing to you, all ye that pass by, behold, and see if there be any sorrow like unto my sorrow, which is done unto me, wherewith the Lord hath afflicted me. All we like sheep have gone astray. We have turned everyone to his own way, and the Lord hath laid on him the iniquity of us all. The Lord be with you.
And with thy spirit.
Let us pray. Lord, have mercy upon us.
Christ, have mercy upon us.
Lord, have mercy upon us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Let us pray. O merciful God, who hast made all men, and hatest nothing that thou hast made, nor desirest the death of a sinner, but rather that he should be converted and live, have mercy upon all who do not know thee, as thou art revealed in the gospel of thy Son. Take from them all ignorance, hardness of heart, and contempt of thy word, and so fetch them home, blessed Lord, to thy fold, that they may be made one flock under one shepherd, Jesus Christ our Lord, who liveth and reigneth with thee and the Holy Spirit, ever one God, world without end.
Amen.
O Savior of the world, who by thy cross and precious blood hast redeemed us,
save us and help us, we humbly beseech thee, O Lord.
In the name of the compassionate Christ, amen.
Jesus knows all about our struggles. He will guide till the day is done. There's not a friend like the lowly Jesus. No, not one. No, not one.
About 6 weeks ago in Minneapolis, where I've been living part-time, I was driving and singing that because I was nervous. And today I'm singing it again because I'm nervous. But so happy, so very happy to be with you. I was nervous driving a car in an unfamiliar city. And I was by myself, and I was driving for a medical appointment on the other side of town, which meant crossing the Mississippi River. And I hadn't been there before, so I used the GPS, or the sat-nav, I guess, and I had it going. And I'm driving along, and I suddenly realize I'm about to come to the intersection of Chicago Avenue and 38th Street, also known as George Floyd Memorial Square. I was coming to the traffic circle. It's not really a square. There's a circle there, and you come around, and what used to be cut food is now Unity Food, but the memorials to George Floyd, who died at the hands of police on that terrible day 4 years ago, The memorials are there as if it had just happened. There are fresh flowers, and there are murals. Did I stop? No, I did not. I would feel a little better if I had, but I was anxious to be on my way. I didn't want to be late for my important appointment. And besides, it was a traffic circle, also an occasion for me to be nervous behind the wheel. I didn't stop. And besides, passing through there made me feel anxious and sad and tired. No time to stop, to pray, and besides, where would I put the car? Is it nothing to you, all you that pass by? Come and see whether there is any sorrow like unto my sorrow. So today, you and I are going to stop for this other tragic and terrible death in Jerusalem 2,000 years ago, the crucifixion of one Jesus of Nazareth on a hill called Golgotha. This time, yes, let's stop. We're going to deliberately take in as much time as we can, whether we're at home online or sitting here in Fifth Avenue. We're going to take some time to listen, to sit, and to pray in a way that's intensely personal, but which is meant to draw us into such a deep place of communion with our Lord Jesus Christ that when we're done, we will be so much better with all the rest. Break into the peace within, one Eastern poet says, and in the world outside, you will easily manage the 10,000 things. So understanding that the 10,000 things are still there, the world is still suffering, I won't do the list, we come to pray. And we're invited to pray in a particular way. It's a little bit like role play. I want you to come with me today and pray as if you were there at Golgotha on that very day, in that very hour. Find your place among the onlookers there and listen to the last seven things that Jesus said. Now, just a tiny tutorial. These words come from four different Gospels in the New Testament, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. And they don't always match up. And if you in a moment between talks, maybe you'll look and see that the citations say where they come from and which gospel. And yes, it does make a difference because there are different voices coming to us across the years, carrying what was initially hearsay, written after the Apostle Paul wrote 1 Corinthians. These things, we don't say so much that they were written as that they were written down, captured from the air. The stories that people had told over the years, and I like to think it's like my mother and her three sisters. When they got to talking about their parents and grandparents, they each had a different version of the story. Same people, same events, but a little detail here, a little shading there that helped me to see who those people were. So instead of Eva, Marie, Elsie, and Glendora, we have Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, and their branches of the Christian family continuing the stories as they told them. And so, to this first word from Luke, sometimes called the great physician who gives us the most human sounding Jesus. Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. Forgive them. Who? Who is he forgiving? Well, first thought, for me at least, is the soldiers who have just nailed him to that cross, and those who have beat and stripped and tormented him, the few who are gambling with his clothes nearby. Then there are the onlookers, the crowd that came. We tend to want to look away from that, but in the United States as recently as the 1930s, crowds would gather to watch lynchings. To come to a public execution might have been a thing, and those people would have been jeering and taunting Jesus. Oh, but if you go a little deeper, it's not just those bad guys. If you remember, the story of the Passion, as it came through on Palm Sunday and into last night, the disciples, for the most part, have run away. Remember that? They're not there. With one exception, we'll come back to later. They're not there. They've scattered, they've fled, they were likely afraid that they would be taken up in the net that was gathering up Jesus. So Peter, who lied last night to say that he didn't even know Jesus, is Jesus forgiving him? Or the Jewish authorities, or the Sanhedrin, or Pontius Pilate, that I think of him as the patron saint of white liberals. Is he forgiving Pontius Pilate? Oh, and then there's Judas. There's Judas, who betrayed him with a kiss while he was praying. Whoa. So this is a portrait, I would think, of human beings at their worst. Good people chickening out and doing bad things, bad people doing bad things. It's a terrible mess, and Jesus is forgiving them. You know, that's not all that popular. The very word forgiveness can just make some of us so angry, depending on what the situation is. It's fine for us to be forgiven, but what about those other people? But if we're going to do this work with integrity, we need to be at the cross as people who are ourselves in need of forgiveness, and just for a little while, forget the others. Can you? T.S. Eliot wrote, "Go, go, go, said the bird. Humankind cannot bear very much reality." The work of Good Friday is for us to see if we can bear a little more reality about our world, about our lives, about ourselves. So do this. Wherever you are, be here, be there at the cross. Receive this forgiveness. It is for us.
Let us pray. O God, who hast made of one blood all the peoples of the earth, and didst send thy blessed Son to preach peace to those who are far off and to those who are near, grant that people everywhere may seek after thee and find thee. Bring the nations into thy fold. Pour out thy Spirit upon all flesh, and hasten the coming of thy kingdom. Through the same thy Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen.
O Savior of the world, who by thy cross and precious blood hast redeemed us,
save us and help us, we humbly beseech thee, O Lord.
We read Psalm responsibly, pausing briefly at the half verse. Hear my prayer, O Lord, and let my crying come unto thee.
Hide not thy face from me in the time of my troubles. Incline thine ear unto me when I call. O hear me and I trust.
For my days are consumed away like smoke, and my bones are burnt up as it were a firebrand.
My heart is smitten down, and withered my breast. So that I forget to eat my bread.
For the voice of my groaning, my bones will scarce cleave to my flesh.
I am upon my belly in the wilderness.
I have watched and am even as it were a sparrow that sitteth alone upon the housetop.
My enemies revile me all day long, and they that are mad upon me are sworn together against me.
For I have eaten ashes as it were bread, and mingled my drink with weeping.
And that was the divine indignation and wrath. For thou hast taken me up and cast me down.
My days are gone like a shadow, and I am withered like grass.
But thou, O Lord, shalt endure forever, and thy
thou shalt arise and have mercy upon Zion. For it is time that thou have mercy upon her, yea, the time is come.
And why thy servants think upon her stones? And it pity them to see her in the dust.
The nations shall fear thy name, O Lord, and all the kings of the earth thy majesty.
When the Lord shall build up Zion, and when his glory shall appear.
When he turneth him unto the prayer of the poor destitute, and despiseth not their desire.
And we come to the second word, which comes right after the word you just heard from the Gospel of Luke. If you were to look in the leaflet or in reading in a Bible, you would see that there's no break. Jesus has just extended blanket forgiveness for those who do not know what they do. And yet there are others still taunting him. Among those who are taunting him are two other men being crucified on crosses to the right and to the left. One of them has that Jesus, come down off that cross, save yourself and us. But the other takes Jesus' part and says, you know, you and I, we're getting what we came for. We're being punished justly. But this man has done nothing wrong. And with that, he turns to Jesus and says, remember me when you come into your kingdom. Remember me. What a request. Remember me. Oscar Wilde apparently said, the only thing worse than having people talk about us is having no one talk about us. If we're forgotten, no one talks about us anymore. And some of us live in fear of that day when we will be forgotten. It comes in time, but we don't want it to happen in our lifetimes. As we grow older and anticipate perhaps an end of life in some sort of assisted living situation, where we were once called Colonel, but now we're Joe, or we were Reverend, and now we're Sue. No one realizes who we were or what we did in our younger years. Don't know that we ran a marathon or whatever it was, of which we've been so very proud. The things we did to make our families proud or not. We'd like to be remembered. We don't just want to disappear in a fog of old age or isolation. How much worse it must be, though, for men and women who are incarcerated, hoping not to be forgotten over the course of a 20-year sentence. You know, I have to say, one of the happiest Holy Weeks I ever had was when the parish choir in Christ Church Rye was invited to go to join the prisoners at Sing Sing for Maundy Thursday, the day that Jesus was arrested. The first time we went, we had no idea what we were doing. We got there, for example, and didn't anticipate a screening process that makes TSA at the airport look like a cakewalk, giving up watches, bangles, books, belts, lots of things to pass through one at a time. We were checked to see if our skirts were long enough and whether our shoulders were bare. Took a long time, and I frankly thought, but at the time we reached the chapel where our congregation was waiting for us, that they would be cranky. I mean, it would stand to reason. They're confined, they're out of, have no control or agency over their time and their lives. How annoying to have this choir turn up so late. I couldn't have been more wrong. When we got to the auditorium cum chapel, we passed down the side aisles as they cheered and sang. They had a pickup band. They had a bass guitar, another guitar, a drum kit, a keyboard, and they were singing and cheering because we had come there. Because we'd come there. Wow, the chaplain, Patero Sabuni, turned to me at one point and said, oh, this is heaven. This is heaven. We sang to them. I got to sing with the choir because it was the Stainer, God So Loved the World, easy enough for me. I got to sing with the choir. We sang to them. They sang to us. And Sabuni, Patero Sabuni, especially, he would lead the songs. And there was one that we learned that day, I Want Jesus to Walk With Me. Through my joy and through my sorrow, I want Jesus to walk with me. And then, I am not forgotten. You are not forgotten. We are not forgotten. Jesus knows our name. I am not forgotten. Jesus knows my name. He knows my name. So what did Jesus say to the man who hung on the cross next to him? You will be with me. You will be with me in paradise today.
Let us pray. Bring us, O Lord God, at our last awakening into the house and gate of heaven, to enter into that gate and dwell in that house, where there shall be no darkness nor dazzling, but one equal light, no noise nor silence, but one equal music, no fears nor hopes, but one equal possession, no ends nor beginnings, but one equal eternity, in the habitation of thy glory and dominion, world without end.
Amen.
O Savior of the world, who by thy cross and precious blood hast redeemed us,
save us and help us. We humbly beseech thee, O Lord.
Blessed is he whose unrighteousness is forgiven and whose sin is covered. For whilst I held my tongue, my bones consumed away through my daily complaining.
For thy hand was heavy upon me day and night, and my moisture was like the drought of the summer.
I acknowledged my sin unto thee, and mine unrighteousness have I not hid.
I said,
for this shall everyone that is godly make his prayer unto thee in a time when thou mayest be found. Surely the great water flood shall not come nigh him.
Thou art raised to high again, thou shalt preserve me from trouble. Thou shalt compass me about the songs of deliverance.
I will inform thee and teach thee in the way wherein thou shalt go, and I will guide thee with mine eye.
Be not like the horse of mule, which hath no understanding, whose mind is turned on a bit of earth, else it will not obey thee.
Great plagues remain for the ungodly, but whoso putteth his trust in the Lord, mercy embraceth him on every side.
Be glad, O ye righteous, and rejoice in the Lord. And be joyful, all ye that are true of heart.
For this third word, we shift to the gospel according to John. Quite different from the others. Jesus, according to John, is so often in full possession of himself, he hardly seems to suffer. He's so strong. And so it is that from the cross, he looks down upon his mother, and John, called the beloved disciple or Jesus' best friend. An awkward position to be in as one of 12. The best, the first, the most beloved. But note well, he's here at the cross, when at least according to the other accounts, the other disciples have run away. And he's here. And he's here with Jesus' mother. He's here with Jesus' mother. Now, Mary, the mother of Jesus, is actually among a group of Marys. There's Mary Magdalene, There's Mary, who might have been the wife of Cleopas. There might have been as many as four Marys there. Very popular name. But we're sure that the main one was Mary, his mother. And she stood there and watched as this went on. So taking care for his mother, he says to her, "Woman, I know that sounds disrespectful, it's not." He may have meant all women, the new Eve. It's actually a gesture of respect, I think. "Woman, I see you. Here is your son, John." Now, here's where John and I part company, because I, as a mother of three, one of whom is a son, I do not want a replacement. I do not want a replacement son. What mother who has lost a child under any circumstances, even before birth, wants to hear, "You'll have another"? You cannot replace a child. You cannot. Which is why when we come to Mary, we do begin to come to the genuine sadness of the hour, because she is watching her son die. And he is taking care of her. In my struggle to get my head around this, I read a commentary that suggested that legally, Jesus could give his mother and John to one another, that that relationship would be binding, so that John, as Mary approached her later years, would literally take care of her, which in the ancient Near East meant a lot. What if she were widowed? She would have no means of support if there was another son. The Gospels are hazy about how this was supposed to work. So Jesus is being sure that his mother is taken care of. And I'm quite certain that that is the point of the passage. However, they stayed. You notice how even through the darkest and most tragic of stories, there is this thread, this glint of gold of human compassion. They stayed. In the Garden of Gethsemane, Jesus had asked Peter, James, and John to wait 1 hour. This will go on to 3. And they're not going anywhere. They will be there. So here in this tale of betrayal and loss, we find a thread of faithfulness, of love, of constancy. Here is Mother Mary. Here is Brother John. And they are there for Jesus to the bitter end. As Shakespeare wrote, "Love bears it out even to the edge of doom." And Paul said, "Love bears all things." These lines from Rainer Maria Rilke come to mind from his Book of Hours. There's also this to see. Blessed are the ones who never turned away, and blessed are those who stood quietly in the rain. Theirs shall be the harvest, for them the fruits. They will outlast the pomp and power whose meanings and structures will crumble. When all else is exhausted and bled of purpose, they shall lift their hands that have survived.
Let us pray. O God, when thy Son Jesus Christ was lifted high upon the cross, thou deignedst that his mother should stand close by and share his suffering. Grant that thy church, participating with the Virgin Mary in the passion of Christ, may merit a share in his resurrection, who liveth and reigneth with thee in the unity of the Holy Spirit ever, one God, world without end.
Amen.
O Savior of the world, who by thy cross and precious blood hast redeemed us.
Save us and help us, we humbly beseech thee, O Lord.
Out of the deep have I called unto thee, O Lord. Lord, hear my voice. If thou, Lord, wilt be extreme to mark what is done amiss, O Lord, who may abide it?
For there is mercy with thee, therefore shalt thou be feared.
I look for the Lord, my soul doth wait for him. In his word is my trust. O Israel, trust in the Lord, for with the Lord there is mercy, and with him is plenteous redemption.
And he shall redeem Israel from all his sins.
And now to the fourth word. A few weeks ago, our grandson, who was almost three, but really still two, he's big for his age and he's strong, and yes, he can be terrible. I don't know what it was that had upset him. He was there with his parents. He got his hands under the white metal play table, and he flipped it. His parents were so stunned that it was still there in that position on the floor, top down, when his grandfather and I got there later that afternoon. I don't know if it was a proof of his strength or something about his personality and passion. He flipped the table. Just like Jesus in the temple, we do know what made Jesus angry enough to flip tables when the money changers who were facilitating the temple ritual were there. We might say they got on his last nerve, and he flipped the tables, fashioned a whip out of cord, and drove the animals away, upending the whole enterprise. So Jesus was capable of anger and rage and despair. My God, why have you forsaken me? All right, it's the first line of a psalm, Psalm 22. He could have been just reciting scripture, but for my money, he used the words that came so well to mind. My God, why have you forsaken me? And it's not Abba, it's not that soft daddy-like title this time, it's Eloi. It's the ancient name. Why have you forsaken me? Why? Now, a lot of people wish he hadn't said this. Wish he had not said this. But they couldn't suppress it, could they? There are two reasons. In your leaflet, it says it came from Matthew, but it also comes from Mark, which is the oldest of the Gospels, and the one where we feel the most certainty that we're really hearing an eyewitness. Yeah, he really did say it. He really did say it. But was it an embarrassment to think that God, the Son of God, felt betrayed by God? I mean, it's a mind twister. Was he separated from himself? Had he abandoned himself? Had he lost his moorings? Was he out of his mind? Was the pain so excruciating that he couldn't be himself any longer? That creates a whole raft of theological problems about who we believe Jesus is over the centuries. But gee whiz. Notice that he doesn't say that God doesn't exist. This is an entirely different sort of complaint. He addresses God directly and says, "Why have you abandoned me?" He didn't say, "I've gotten lost," like a kid in the grocery store who gets separated from his mom. "Where did you go, my partner in mission, my father? Whose idea was this anyway? Am I not doing this for you? Didn't we have an agreement? Do you not love me anymore? Have I done something wrong? Was I mistaken about this work? Was I wrong? Was it worth it? Why have you forsaken me?" How can Jesus, of all people, not understand that God is still there? Well, I think this is one of those times when we have to hold two impossible things in tension. He knew that God was still there, and he knew that God was not there. Not there. Like looking at the dark side of the moon. The moon is still there, but you cannot see it. You cannot see it. Jesus had to experience this. If, as we believe, he was going to know what it was like to be human, then he had to know what it was like not to be able to see God. That is the defining mark of our mortality. Since our expulsion from the Garden of Eden, we cannot see God anymore. And Jesus could not be fully human if he didn't have at least a moment of that terrible blindness and the despair that can come with it. So, is this common to the life of faith? Did Jesus want us to know? Was it all right for him, for us to hear, that he thought God had just cut him off? I think it's terribly important for us. It's terribly important. Because we're apt to confuse faith with certainty. And we think sometimes we can't see God or we can't feel God. We don't feel God in the same, perhaps emotional, uplifting way that we did at a certain time in our lives. Certain part of our journey, God seemed ever-present and so accessible and full of consolation, and then we think we must have done something wrong, right? Here's the evidence that you don't have to do anything wrong to feel this way. It doesn't have to be the result of your sin. In fact, it doesn't make sense for God to do that, actually, to cut us off on account of our sin. This is not tough love, saying, "Okay, Jesus, you blew it, so you're on your own now." That didn't happen that way. One of my favorite and most consoling among the saints is Brother Lawrence, who wrote The Practice of the Presence of God. He lived in the 17th century in France. He was a monk after he had been a soldier and a prisoner of war. He was a monk. And he told someone who came often to visit him, a certain Joseph of Beaufort, that for 4 years he thought he was going to hell. He believed he was damned. He believed he was going to be utterly rejected. It didn't matter what he did, how hard he prayed, how faithfully he kept the office. It didn't matter what he did. It wasn't going to work. But out of love, he stayed. Out of love for 4 years. He thought it wasn't working. And he thought it was his fault. He thought it was his fault. But that ended. And he was able to leave with us from his dying days some of the most beautiful counsel for prayer that exists in the Christian tradition. Mother Teresa, with those private diaries that she hoped would never be published. No wonder she didn't want them published. She felt that God had abandoned her, that she no longer had the intimate contact with Jesus Christ that had been the purpose of her whole life. It went into darkness for her, and it's dangerous stuff. It's dangerous stuff if we would be tempted to believe that Mother Teresa didn't know what she was doing or that God had abandoned her. No wonder she didn't want it in the hands of the public. But she went there. You know, Madeleine L'Engle, the great writer and friend in the Episcopal Church, used to say that she thought the big risk Jesus took was not getting crucified, but becoming a human in the first place. That the incarnation was the big deal. Incarnation is the big deal. Why? Because of this. Because of this psychic suffering, when he felt he could not see God at all. Jesus went there, as we say. He went there. He felt the darkness, the lack of hope, even abandonment. From our point of view, receiving this, this is not just courage. This is love. For us, he experienced it all. Does this not make him our truest friend?
Let us pray. O God, thou hast made us in thine own image and redeemed us through Jesus Christ, thy only Son. Look with compassion on the whole human family. Take away the arrogance and hatred which infect our hearts. Break down the walls that separate us. Unite us in bonds of love and work through our struggle and confusion to accomplish thy purposes on earth, that in thy good time all nations and races may serve thee in harmony around thy heavenly throne. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen.
O Savior of the world, who by thy cross and precious blood has redeemed us.
Save us and help us, we humbly beseech thee, O Lord.
My God, look upon me. Why hast thou forsaken me? And art so far from my health and from the words of my complaint?
O Lord God, I cry in the daytime, but thou hearest not. And in the night season also I take no rest.
And thou continuest holy, O thou worship of Israel. They called upon thee and were helpen. They put their trust in thee and were not confounded.
But as for me, I am a worm and no man, a very sword of men and the outcast of the people.
All they that see me laugh me to scorn. They shoot out their lips and shake their head, saying,
He trusted in the Lord that he would deliver him. Let him deliver him if he will have him.
But thou art he that took me out of my mother's womb. Thou wast my hope when I hanged yet upon my mother's breasts. O go not from me, for trouble is hard at hand, and there is none to help me.
May many oxen have come about me, but fat bulls of Bashan close me in on every side.
They gape upon me with their mouths, as it were ramping and a roaring lion. My strength is dried up like a potsherd, and my tongue cleaves to my gums. And thou bringest me into the dust of death.
For many dogs are come about me, and the counsels of the wicked are seen against me.
They pierced my hands and my feet, I may tell all my bones. They stand staring and looking upon me.
They part my garments among them, and cast lots on my vesture.
But be not thou far from me, O Lord. Thou art my succor. Haste thee to help me.
And we come to the fifth word. I thirst. December 28, 1905, in the Englewood neighborhood of Chicago, a young Salvation Army officer by the name of Arthur Follett went down to the storefront mission to try and set up a Christmas party for the children of the neighborhood, which was a very poor one. He had a special surprise, a magic lantern. It was a stereopticon, a very primitive film projector, fueled by an acetylene tank. And he was going to show them pictures from the Bible. But he had gone down to set up the machine and to get things ready for the party, when at about 6:30, the acetylene tank exploded and threw him through the plate glass window, along with his wife and his 16-year-old daughter. Arthur Follett was my great-grandfather, and that daughter was to be my grandmother. Now, two different newspapers recorded the incident. I'm grateful to my second cousin, Ellen, for tracking them down. But what the family said about the accident was a little different and more detailed than what the newspaper said. It must have come down from his widow or my grandmother that as he was being carried off by ambulance to the hospital, he refused painkillers. He didn't want anything for the pain. Now, here's where the legend part comes in, because he said he wanted to pay for his sins. He wanted to experience the pain for his sins. I raise this because there's ambiguity and fuzziness in the different accounts of the crucifixion about whether or not Jesus accepted the vinegar that was offered him to drink. First off, we're not talking vinegar like you put in your coleslaw. Vinegar is a clunky translation. It was sour wine, is what the Roman soldiers had on hand to work with, either to drink themselves or to work with people in the course of crucifixion for two reasons. One, they mixed it with gall or myrrh, and again, the Gospels are a little fuzzy about which it might have been. It would be more of a pain reliever. Now, we don't really, would the Roman soldiers have shown mercy in that way to try to dull the pain? But also, that mixture made it harder for the victims to breathe. Crucifixion works by asphyxiation. The exhaustion of hanging on the cross makes it harder and harder to breathe. And the subtle intoxication of the sour wine would have made it harder still, which would have meant that the Roman soldiers could have called it a day a little bit earlier because they wanted these fellows to die so they could go home. Was it an act of mercy or not? The Gospels are mixed up a little about this. In Matthew and Mark, he's offered it, and in one instance he's refused it, in another it sounds as if he accepted it. And in John, he simply says, I thirst. Protestant theologians over the years have loved the idea that he refused it, especially those in the temperance movement, yeah? What better grounds for abstinence and refusing to drink than to say that even Jesus on the cross wouldn't accept a drink of wine? I don't know about that. But also there's the question of the incarnation again. Did he want to experience it all? did he want to experience all the pain of human existence? I mean, besides the lack of oxygen, nothing but thirst does us more damage. Dehydration kills people. The lack of clean water kills people. We have to drink. We have to drink. So he knew thirst. Now this word is from John. It is from John. And it's couched in a much more deliberate sequence. Jesus knowing that his time was near, that the end was near. Then he said, I thirst. It's almost as if he has to do this or to say this for things to be concluded, for his work to be done. He has to acknowledge the thirst. And you could do some beautiful symbolic devotion and thinking of, oh, what is this? This man who offered living water to the Samaritan woman at the well, how is it that he himself is thirsty? Or is this a reference that, to the blood and water which will flow from his side? But I want to dial it back more to the human side here and think for a minute about what else thirsty means. I'm a big fan of Elizabeth George, the murder mystery author, and I've just about come to the end of what I can read of hers, but there's a key character, Isabel Ardrey, a police officer with a terrible drinking problem. And in one of the later mystery novels, this drinking progresses to the point that it is literally ruining her life. She keeps saying she's thirsty. And the first few times I saw it in the book, I thought, she's thirsty, she's dehydrated, she needs a drink of water. But in the book, she would get a glass of water or she would get some orange juice. And then she'd throw up the orange juice and have some vodka. Because the thirst was for something else. How funny that in the English language we talk about spirits, that the thirst also represents our longing for God. Living water, we want our thirst to be quenched. Jesus knew what it was to yearn, to desire, to need. For those struggling with substance issues, this passage is so important to understand. Jesus is there with us and understands. Sometimes a person will pick up a bottle or a drug to assuage a thirst that isn't physical at all. It is spiritual. Jesus said, I thirst. Oh, but we could pan out, couldn't we? Back to the need for actual water. Living water, clean water in Haiti, in Gaza, in Michigan, in Mexico City. People all over the world are suffering for the lack of clean, abundant water, and they are thirsty for justice. Let justice roll down like waters and righteousness like an ever-flowing stream. Come, Lord Jesus, and bring to us that living water at last, that our every thirst might be quenched.
Let us pray. Almighty God, we thank thee that by the death and resurrection of thy Son, Jesus Christ, thou hast overcome sin and brought us to thyself, and that by the sealing of thy Holy Spirit, thou hast bound us to thy service. Renew in us, thy servant, the covenant thou madest with us at our baptism. Send us forth in the power of thy Spirit to perform the service that thou hast set before us. Through Jesus Christ, thy Son, our Lord, who liveth and reigneth with thee and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
O Savior of the world, who by thy cross and precious blood hast redeemed us,
save us and help us, we humbly beseech thee, O Lord.
Save me, O God, for the waters are coming, even unto my soul. I am weary of crying, my throat is dry. My sight faileth me for waiting so long upon my God.
They that hate me without cause are more than the hairs of my head. They that are my enemies and will destroy me guiltless are not.
I paid them the things that I never took. God, thou knowest my simpleness, and my faults are not hid from thee.
Let not them that trust in thee, O Lord God of hosts, be ashamed for my cause. Let not those that seek thee be confounded through thee, O Lord God of Israel.
And why? For thy sake have I suffered reproof. Shame hath covered my face.
I am become a stranger unto my brethren. Even an alien unto my mother's children.
For the zeal of thine house hath even eaten me. And the rebukes of them that rebuked thee are fallen upon me.
I wept.
I put on sackcloth also, and they jested upon me.
They that sit in the gates speak against me, and the drunkards make songs upon me.
But Lord, I make my prayer unto thee in an acceptable time.
Hear me, O God, in the multitude of thy sins.
Take me out of mire, that I sink not. O, let me be delivered from them that hate me, and out of the deep waters.
Let not the water flood drown me, neither let the deep swallow me up. And let not the pit shut my mouth upon me.
Hear me, O Lord, for thy loving kindness is comfortable. Turn thee unto me according to the multitude of thy mercies.
And hide not thy face from thy servants, for I am troubled. O haste thee and hear me.
Draw nigh unto my soul and save it. O deliver me because of mine enemies. Reproach hath broken my heart, I am full of heaviness. I looked for some to have pity on me, but there was no man, neither found I any to comfort me.
And the sixth word from the cross, Jesus said, "It is finished." This comes from the Gospel of John. In two other Gospels, it's not his final word. He doesn't say it. He says something else. But in John's Gospel, he says, "It is finished." So here's one possible last word from him. On the East Yorkshire tombstone of the author Winifred Holtby, these words are carved. "Lord, give me work till my life shall end, and life till my work is done. Give me life till my work is done." When Jesus says it's finished, does he mean we're all done here, or there's nothing more I can do? Is this time's up, pencils down, click send? Is it the last possible moment? Yes. Is it defeat? No. But the finality of it, if we were in Ireland, this is where the keening would begin, yes? Because by his saying it's finished, it means he's going. So many of you have been at the bedside of a loved one as they were dying and found a moment when somebody had to say, "It's okay, you can go." When you realize that the suffering of your beloved has just become too much, unbearable to watch, unbearable for them to endure, and you wonder if they're hanging on for you, and you need to say, "It's okay, let go." But they may well be wondering, "Is it finished? For you and for me, I don't know. Did you write the will? Are your affairs in order? Is there someone to whom you owe an apology that you didn't make? Were there words of love and thanks you meant to send? Were there revisions in the text of your life that you're leaving behind?" We fear the end. Yes, we fear the pain for sure, the suffering and all of that, but this last breath, this impossibility of going back and fixing anything ever again, it's terrifying. Terrifying. And for Jesus, I mean, surely it was a relief for him to say it's finished. After all, this is John, where Jesus' life is his work and his work is his life, and if the work is done, he is too, and that's it. There's no more reason for him to stay in this earthly body if the work is done, if he's passing it on to us. It's finished. There's nothing left to be done. But for us, and for those who were with him that day, the revolution had not come. The Romans still in charge and as brutal as ever. Hunger still a problem. Children still dying before their first birthdays, wars breaking out, terrible things going on Is the work done? Is it finished? Or is there some great change about to occur? Is he giving in, or is he signing off and entrusting some of this into our hands? Whichever it is, this is the moment of separation. They do not believe at this moment that they will ever hear his voice in human tones again. And certainly none of them is remembering at the moment that he's promised to come back from the dead. I don't think I would remember either, would you? He's declaring that it's over. I like to think that he had done everything he wanted to do, the way that you and I would hope for someone we love in our lifetimes, that they've been able to do, to say, to feel, to experience everything they wanted in life. We certainly want that for ourselves, and if we're blessed enough to have work, serious work that we believe only we can do, yes, I hope we have life enough and time. But we have no guarantee, do we? What would it mean for you, for me? I mean, I hate to get heavy-handed here, but what if this afternoon one of us had to say it's finished? It's the end. It can come quickly. We would like to know that we could pass through and away from this world with no unfinished business. How are we doing with that? Listen, use this as an excuse. If you do owe somebody an apology, hey, 3:30 today is your perfect opportunity to say thanks, to express love, to give kindness, to forgive that one last person who's still you've been unable to release. Why not? Why not? To have the grace to finish the work, the life we've been given. Wouldn't that be wonderful? There was a priest in the Episcopal Church by the name of James Simpson who died in 2002. Most of his work was in Washington, but he also helped out at St. Michael's up on the Upper West Side. And Jim Simpson puzzled me. He was earlier formed in his priesthood than I was, shall we say. I was really quite young at the time. But he had this uncanny habit. Whenever he had a weekday Eucharist, celebration of the Holy Communion, he would end not with the blessing, he would do that, but then he would kneel in the center aisle of the chapel where we were and say the prayer for evening. Go figure. 8:30 in the morning, 12 noon, didn't matter, prayer for evening. He may have learned it in another parish. I came to associate it with funerals. Perhaps you know it. O Lord, support us all the day long of this troublous life. Until the shadows lengthen and the evening comes, and the busy world is hushed, and the fever of life is over, and our work is done. Then in thy mercy grant us safe lodging and a holy rest and peace at the last. Knowing that we too will die someday, can we pray for those whose last breaths will be taken on this day? Spare a thought for them and for ourselves. that they might pass out of this world with a sense of relief and accomplishment, of a job well done, and a sense of completion. May they know the portal of death to be a portal into a new reality where life is changed, not ending, where all that is hidden will be revealed, where there is nothing left to be done, and that all may be well.
Let us pray. Lord Jesus Christ, who didst stretch out thine arms of love on the hard wood of the cross, that everyone might come within the reach of thy saving embrace, so clothe us in thy spirit that we, reaching forth our hands in love, may bring those who do not know thee to the knowledge and love of thee, for the honor of thy name. Amen. O Savior of the world, who by thy cross and precious blood hast redeemed us,
save us and help us, we humbly beseech thee, O Lord.
The Lord is my light and my salvation, whom then shall I fear? The Lord is the strength of my life, of whom then shall I be afraid?
When the wicked, even my enemies and my foes, came upon me to eat up my flesh, they stumbled and fell.
Though an host of men were laid against me, yet shall not my heart be afraid. And though there rose up war against me, yet will I put my trust in him.
One thing have I desired of the Lord, which I will require, even that I may dwell in the house of the Lord all the days of my life, to behold the fair beauty of the Lord, and to visit his temple.
For in the time of trouble he shall hide me in his tabernacle. Yea, in the secret place of his dwelling shall he hide me and set me up upon a rock of stone.
And now shall he lift up my head above my enemies round about me.
Therefore will I offer in his dwelling an oblation with great gladness. I will sing and speak praises unto the Lord. My heart hath talked of thee, seek ye my face. Thy face, Lord, will I seek.
O hide not thou thy face from me, nor pass thy servant away in this flesh.
Thou hast been my succor. Leave me not, neither forsake me, O God of my salvation. Teach me thy way, O Lord, and lead me in the right way because of mine enemies.
Deliver me not over to the will of my adversaries. For there are false witnesses risen up against me, and such as speak wrong.
I should utterly have fainted, but that I believe verily to see the goodness of the Lord in the land of the living.
O tarry not the ones of judgment. Be strong, and ye shall comfort thy heart, and put thou thy trust in the Lord.
So the seventh and final word given us by the Gospel of Luke. The other Gospels simply say he cried out with a loud voice. Luke gives us the words, Father, into thy hands I commend my Spirit. That's it. That's the end. Having done all that he can do and suffered all that he can suffer, Jesus breathes his last and gives us the last of the teaching, which is how to die. How to die so that we can live. Into thy hands I commend my spirit. In my earliest days in New York on the Upper West Side, there was an unlikely evangelist in the person of a graffiti artist. I'm convinced it was a woman. Not the big tag and colorful letters we see now on subway cars and such, but thinly drawn letters scratched into the metal walls of ladies' rooms with what may have only been a ballpoint pen. Pray, the messages said. Obey God. Trust God. Trust God. This is what Jesus finally is teaching us to do, is to trust God. In the Common English Bible, it's rendered a little differently. He says, Father, into your hands I entrust my life. But there's this gesture of giving over, of putting one's life into the hands of God, trusting God. Can we? You know, Jesus talked so much about faith, and sometimes we have trouble working with this, because when we say the creed, we say, I believe in God. Since the Enlightenment, we get confused and we think we're making a factual statement about history in a way that only a latter-day person would think of it. Our presiding bishop, Michael Curry, likes to remind us that I believe, credo, in this earliest sense, means something more like I give my heart to. They were looking for the verb that means faith. How do you have faith? You give your heart to something or someone. It's not a yes, no question, right? It's a question of our giving over. Can we trust God? Our sometime Suffragan bishop, Catherine Roscom, told a story many years ago that I called her to ask about a few weeks back. She's working in France, by the way, for the year. She had told a story in a sermon that she gave about a fire that occurred in her New York apartment when she was a young woman with a husband and child living on the West Side. I believe it was somewhere in the 30s. It was a walk-up building. And she was awakened in the middle of the night by a neighbor who was pounding on the doors of every apartment, telling people to get out of the building because he had unwittingly set fire to it from the first floor below. And the smoke was beginning to billow up. And Catherine quickly gathered her 2-year-old daughter, woke up her husband, and tried to figure out what to do. What to do? The smoke was coming up so heavily from a floor below that she couldn't see out the window and didn't know what to do from there. And of course, she mustn't go back into the building or the stairwell where the smoke was coming in from under the door. But help came, and a firefighter came, and she heard the reassuring clunk of a ladder coming to rest on the wall below her window. And with the encouragement and the timing of the fireman who was there to help her by then, was able to stand up, take her daughter in her arms, turn around, and put her foot down the ladder and begin the climb down to safety. She had to trust the fireman, her foot, the ladder. She made it safely. She made it safely. That's trust. We talked about it, and you know, I had a feeling, I thought, I wonder if she really wants to tell this story again after all these years. It's a pretty traumatic thing to be rescued from a fire like that. She didn't seem to mind, and I realized she had used the word miracle 3 times in the course of the story. The miracle of the fireman arriving in time, the miracle of the ladder hitting the wall, the miracle of a friend emerging with an empty apartment for the family to live in the first days after the fire. Miracle, miracle, miracle. She trusted with her life. Now, the funny thing about this, you know how stories change in time, and I'm so glad I called her because I had the story wrong. What I heard her say the first time when she told it was that she had gone to the window, grabbed her daughter, and fallen backward into a net, which would have been even more terrifying and downright foolish, and certainly more dramatic. But when we talk about trusting God, I think the image we're looking for is that stepping out onto the ladder. We're not falling into anything. We are giving, entrusting, offering our lives to God, leaving things in the hands of God. Kierkegaard called it the leap of faith. T.S. Eliot in The Wasteland called it the awful daring of a moment's surrender which an age of prudence can never retract. Or as some people like to say, you let go and let God. Going back to Brother Lawrence, 6 days before his death, he said, if we have done all we can, the change we desire is soon to follow. If we have done all we can, the change we desire is soon to follow. Have we done all we can? Brothers and sisters, we get stuck. We have insoluble problems, intractable, long-standing, complicated, well-armed, fierce problems. We are in way over our heads so much of the time. We can't even watch the news some nights. We are in way over our heads. It's not giving up to give over our lives to God and to stop believing that we can fix the universe. Because that's not the way it works. We don't get to fix the universe. It belongs to God, who happily will do it with us, who calls and pleads and invites and longs for us to be there. To be there with God, with Jesus, with the suffering, with the suffering. Can we go with Jesus in this final journey, and can we trust Jesus to be alongside when our moment comes? All will be well, and all will be well, and all manner of things will be well. Trust God.
Thank you.
Let us confess our faith in Christ crucified by saying the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended in heaven and seated on the right hand of God, Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And with thy spirit.
Let us pray. O Lamb of God, who takest away the sins of the world, O Lamb of God, who takest away the sins of the world,
have mercy on us.
O Lamb of God, who takest away the sins of the world,
grant us thy peace.
O Christ, hear us.
O Christ, hear us.
Lord, have mercy upon us.
Lord, have mercy upon us.
Christ, have mercy upon us.
Christ, have mercy upon us.
Lord, have mercy upon us.
Lord, have mercy upon us.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Let us pray. Almighty God, whose most dear Son went not up to joy, but first he suffered pain, and entered not into glory before he was crucified, mercifully grant that we, walking in the way of the cross, may find it none other than the way of life and peace, through the same thy Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen.
Almighty and everlasting God, who of thy tender love towards mankind hast sent thy Son, our Savior Jesus Christ, to take upon him our flesh and to suffer death upon the cross, that all mankind should follow the example of his great humility. Mercifully grant that we may both follow the example of his patience and also be made partakers of his resurrection. Through the same Jesus Christ, our Lord. Keep watch, dear Lord, with those who work or watch or weep this night, and give thine angels charge over those who sleep. Tend the sick, Lord Christ, give rest to weary, bless the dying, soothe the suffering, pity the afflicted, shield the joyous, and all for thy love's sake. We adore thee, O Christ, and we bless thee.
Because of thy holy cross, thou hast redeemed the world.
May the souls of the faithful departed, through mercy of God, rest in peace.